Good morning. We're back again. God has blessed us to see another new month of the year. The month of March is first Sunday. God has blessed us, and we've come through this ice storm, and God has blessed us through that. And God is just so good. Jesus, his son, is so worthy to be praised. And we give all praise and all honor, glory go to God. Amen. Amen. And God shows us he has the power. Amen. And, you know, God has blessed us. We've been good. We're still going through this pandemic. Look like our numbers are counting down. And we still want you to continue to not get so comfortable. Still do our social distancing. Still continue to wash our hands and continue to get vaccinated. Okay. All right. And we're going to go, before we get in our word, we're going to go to God in prayer. And then we'll get started in our Sunday school lesson for today. Amen. Let us go to God in prayer. Most gracious and everlasting Father, we come today, dear Lord, said thank you for another day. Oh God, you allowed us to see another new month of the year. Oh dear Lord, so many have passed and gone before us, dear Lord. But oh God, you still have us here. And we just like to say thank you one more time, dear Lord. Oh God, thanking you for your only begotten son, Jesus, today. And dear Lord, we thank you for our pastor. We thank you for our associate pastors, dear Lord. And oh God, we thank you for this day and blessing us through the way of technology, dear Lord. We ask you just remember all little church doors that are opening our name today that's going through technology, dear Lord. And oh God, we ask you to bless those that are sick and shut in. Touch and let them know, dear Lord, that all sickness is not unto death. And most of all, dear Father, we just thank you for your word today. Thanking you for allowing your word to be a guide in our life. And, oh, God, we ask you just to have mercy upon those that don't know you today, dear Lord. And, oh, God, we just ask you to forgive us of our sins of omission and our sins of commission today, dear Lord. And, oh, God, we ask you to bless those that still may be lying on the sick bed of affliction, dear Lord. And, oh, God, we ask you to continue to bless the city of Jackson or the situation that they are going through with this water problem, dear Lord. And we ask you to continue to bless the mayor. Hold him up, Father, through all the things that they are going through in this city. And dear Father, we know you're going to see him through, dear Lord. And oh God, we thank you for life, health, and strength today. And thank you for blessing my family, dear Lord. And oh God, we thank you for blessing our church family, dear Lord. And oh Father, we ask you to continue to bless us that we may continue to lift up your most precious and holy name. And this is our prayer. In the mighty son Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right, we coming out of the Old Testament today. We're coming out of the book of Leviticus this morning. And our next three lessons for the next 3 weeks in the month of March, we'll be talking about holiness. And, you know, that's one word in the church that we hardly hear people talk about, being holy, you know. And, then, you know, look like they said, when you say like you're holy, you're better than somebody else. No, you're no better than nobody else. But holy means set apart. And our purpose statement is to understand what it means to live as God's holy people. If we're children of God, we're supposed to be holy people. Amen. We're supposed to be different from the world. We're supposed to be set apart. Amen. I used to tell this Sunday school class all the time. When people see us, they ought to be able to see Christ in our life. Amen. Amen. And we're going to get ready to read our scriptures. Our scriptures are pretty long today, but we're going to read verses 1 through 3, and then we will skip down to 11 through 14. Amen. All right. If you have your Bibles, and if you're reading along with us, we're coming out of Leviticus 19, 1 through 18, but we'll only read the first three verses, and then we'll skip down to 11 to 14. Amen. And it reads, and this is the Lord talking, saying to Moses, we're talking about these Israelites. They're coming out of the land of Egypt. Amen. And the Lord said to Moses, say to the whole community of Israelites, you must be holy because I, the Lord, your God, am holy. And you know, if we say we're God's children, we're supposed to be holy as well. Amen. The Bible says in the book of Hebrews, verse 11 and 12, it says, chapter 12, verse 14, it says, without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. Amen. That's what the word says. It said, without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. And then it says, Then it goes on to say, so you must be holy because I, the Lord, or your God, am holy. And then verse 3 said, each of you must respect your mother and your father, and you must keep my Sabbath. You know, we don't hear too much of that term of honoring our mother and our father today. You know, when I was growing up, you know, I was taught that if you honor your mother and your father, that your days may be long upon this earth. Amen. And then when we skip all the way down to verse 11, it says, you must not steal, nor deceive, nor lie to each other. You must not swear falsely by my name, desecrating your God's name and doing so. I am the Lord. Then he goes on to say, you must not oppress your neighbor or rob them. Do not withhold or hire laborers, pay overnight. Then verse 14 says, you must not insult a deaf person or put some obstacles in the front of a blind person that will cause them to trip. Instead, fear your God. I am the Lord. You know, fearing God is not saying we're afraid of him, but it's the thing of that we fear God of who he is. Setting an example to understand that God is all knowing, all power. He was sovereign Lord. He don't want us to be afraid of him, but just to respect him and to honor him. Amen. All right. And in the book of the Leviticus is saying these were the laws for the Israelites of everyday life. And the same thing that applied to the Israelites back in the Old Testament days is the same laws that still applies to you and I today. Amen. And it says the basic of all holiness is found in these words. It said, the Lord your God am holy. Various laws for the conduct of the people are here laid down as follows. Mother and father. Honor mother and father were to be reverenced. The fifth commandment, God's Sabbath was to be observed. The fourth commandment, and it said adultery was prohibited. The second commandment, eating in peace offering on the third day was prohibited. In harvesting a field, the owner was to leave some grain in corners of for the poor and strangers. Even in our lesson today, still talking about how we're supposed to help one another and help the poor. And you look at what's going on even in the White House today. You take the senators and all those Republicans and all those people making good money and have good income. And yet still, they still don't want people to have a decent wage pay a living today. Isn't that sad? And then we're going with our writer today. And then we will start out. She's talking about being set apart. This is what the prophet Isaiah described, his speculative vision to God. He said, I saw the Lord sitting up on the throne, high and lofty, separate and in attendance was above him. And one called to another and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. Then even John saw a vision of worship of the heavenly throne was similar. He heard four living creatures singing, holy, 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 the Lord God Almighty was and is to come. That's in Revelation 4, 6, and 8. And God is holy. We serve an almighty and all-powerful God. We serve a holy God. God was holy back then with the Israelites. And guess what? God expecting you and I to be holy today. Amen. And then the definition of again, like I was saying about holy, is a set apart of service for God. I mean, we can't be like the world like we used to be. You know, we can't do the things we used to do when we were living for the world. But now that we're set apart and living for holy things, even our behavior changed. Our attitude changed when we started living for Christ and saying we're living for a holy God and we're being set apart from the world. We just cannot go back and do the things we used to do. Because one thing about living for Christ, you can't be straddled the fence. Either you're saved or you're not. Amen. And then it said, you will be a kingdom and a priest for me, God said, and a holy nation. This is what God was saying to the Israelites. And then on page 8, he said, we do not attain or earn holiness by our own. You cannot earn holiness on your own. If it would be, everybody would be holy. But then the writer goes on and says, God called all us holy because God is our what? Creator. And claims us as children of the divine image. So how can we live and be an example of the world if we as children don't live a holy life before the world? Amen. And then on, it goes on to say on the relationships, it said the first instruction is to respect your mother and your father. You know, we live in a time now we don't hear that term anymore about honoring mother and honoring father. I come up in a single parent home and I had a mother that was a praying mother that took care of 10 children. And even with mom being taken care of, it's one thing that we didn't do. We didn't enter that room when we saw our mother on her knees saying her prayer. But, oh, I thank God for the days and the time that we had mother and that mom taught us. And even being a single parent back then, raising children by herself, even when we was coming up as children, that we didn't cause mama any trouble. There was not a time that mama had to go to a jailhouse or nowhere to see what wrong that our children have done. That's when I thank God for a praying mother. And you're looking at the times which we're living in now, it takes two parents now to raise children. Even sometimes now it's tough for two parents to even raise one child. But even back in them times, we had praying parents. Praying grandparents. And you know, we look at it now, we're in a time where people are just shut up now. People are not praying like they used to. And then on down on page 8, it said, when he said, honor your father and your mother so that your life will be long and fertile that your God has given you. The older people used to tell us that your life may be long when we honor our mothers and our fathers. But then like I said, we're just living in a time now that these laws seem they don't apply to us today. But yes, they do. They're still, if they applied for the Israelites back then, they apply for us today. Amen. And it also says, when the Israelites left Egypt, they stopped at a place called Mount Sinai. And this is where all the laws and all the things God told Moses to tell them what they was to live by. And then now we get on in the back to the sacrificial offering. And it says, have you ever thought of yourself as a member of a holy priesthood? Remember that the priests made the sacrifice to God on behalf of the people. That's what they did back in the olden days. The priests would be a day for atonement, that a day will be set aside that he would go to the Lord on behalf of the people. But we don't have that today. Oh, we can go to Jesus Christ on our own. Amen. We don't need the pastor. We don't need the bishop. We don't need the Sunday school teacher. We can kneel and we can go to God on our own. Amen. That's what's so good about when Christ died on the cross. All that was done away with. And now it also says the spiritual sacrifices we make to God out of our offerings to God, since these offerings are set apart for God, that they are holy. Things that we do for Christ, even in our giving, they are holy. Amen. That means you can't play with your giving when you give to God. You have to be truthful when you give to God. Amen. Because God sees all this. Like I said earlier, our giving is holy to God. Amen. And then over on page 11, the writer mentioned about insults that God was saying not to do to the deaf people or persons or people or putting obstacles in front of blind people. It said, when we treat others with kindness and respect, we are following God's instructions. We also are making a sacrifice or an offering to God. You know, the way people can see Christ in your life is how we have love for one another. If you want somebody to see Christ in your life, you have love for your sisters and your brother. It doesn't matter the color, the size, or where they come from, or where they live. We supposed to love everybody. Amen. This is what God requires us to do. And then he said also that we are sacrificing, giving into our own self-centered desires by looking out for the needs of others. You know, we don't want to look out for the needs of other people. We see the needs of all these disasters that are going on. We need to make a sacrifice to help out, not just look for the government to help take care of people. We're supposed to help one another. Amen. Help somebody that in need. Then the writer goes on to say, at the time of creation, the Lord took the human and settled him in the Garden of Eden to farm it and to take care of it. But when we offer ourselves to care for that which belongs to God, we are answering to God the call to what? Holiness. Amen. All right. And then when we turn on over to the next page, where God says, I am the Lord on page 12. And the phrase, I am the Lord your God, I am the Lord, a recurring phrase in this passage of Leviticus 19:3-4. You must have no other gods before me, because I, the Lord your God, I am loyal and gracious to you. Those who love me will do what? Keep my commandment. God said, look, don't put other things, idle things before me, such as our cars, our homes, our clothes, cell phones. We look at all this stuff. We put more time in it than we do reading and study God's word. Then when death time and sickness come, who'd be the first somebody we call upon? The name of the Lord. We're asking people to pray for us. But God said, look, don't have no other God before me. Amen. Because remember now, God said in his word that what? He is a jealous God. And God can remove these things from us just as quick as we got them. How you say to the Sunday school class all the time, it takes a long time to climb a tree. But it don't take no time. One step missed climbing. Boys know about that back in the day. We used to climb trees. One step and you can find yourself back on the ground. Life is the same way. It takes us almost a lifetime to accumulate all this stuff, houses, cars, and all this stuff. And then we turn around and make idols out of it. And guess what God was saying to the Israelites? And the same thing applied to us today. He said, thou shalt have what? No other gods before me. And then on down it says, the Israelites lived among pagan cultures, and the temptation to follow the practice of these pagan nations was strong. God warned them not to make their own gods of cast metal. Israelites strayed away, like I was saying earlier, how they took and worship idols, how we take things and make idols out of them, put them before God. And God was telling them, don't do these things. And then on down the right, it said, we embrace the call to be holy when we obey the instructions of God. Do not turn to idols. Money, all of that stuff, jewelry. Look, God said, don't turn to idol worship. Gambling and all that stuff, he said, don't do it, because it's what? It separates us from God. Amen. God hates that stuff. And then he said, God calls us to something higher than the secular world we will ever be able to offer. God called us to what? Holiness. God called us to what? Love. And we're supposed to love. One of God's greatest commandments was what? To love. And then in my teacher's book, I write what Christ says. God requires us, a holy God requires us to be what? A holy people. Don't be ashamed to tell somebody that you're holy and that you're living a life for Christ. Because listen now, the word says, if you be ashamed to own me before my father, he said, I'll be ashamed to own you before. If you be ashamed to own you before your friend, he said, I'll be ashamed to own you before my father, which is in heaven. He said, you must be holy first. This is the what? The divine order. Then the writer goes on and said, God is holy, pure, divine, and set apart from what? Other gods. Should not those then who follow the Lord also what? Be holy. It takes time to be holy. It don't happen overnight. Amen. Some of us, some of us had Damascus Road experience. Like Paul was changed from Saul to Paul. And when I had my Damascus Road experience, you go through storms of life, and it teaches us that how God can bring us through storms in life. And it helps us to be delivered from those things that we went through. And this is how we can study God's word and stay in his word, and to understand God is the one that brought me out of those storms. And that helps us to come what? To be holy people for God, set apart from things of the world, that to understand that the world didn't have nothing for us but to use us up. But when we live for Christ, it's a different meaning. Amen. And then we'll go on to say, the writer goes on to say, it says, Israelite was to come into harmony with their God, with their creator, and with one another. Same thing with us today. So much chaos and so much hatred in the world today. But God wants all of us, black, white, yellow, green, you name it. He wants us to do what? Come into harmony with one another. Because the word says now, how can you love a God who you have not seen, though you hate your fellow man who you see every day? Amen. And then in closing and in being holy, the writer goes on to say, holiness is a gift from God. We are made in God's divine image and set apart as what? Beloved children of God. You have to be set apart from the world. Amen. There's no way you can straddle the fence. Even the Bible says you either hot or what? Or cold. You can't be straddling the fence. Amen. And this is our closing, a beautiful lesson today. And in our next lesson, Sister McGinnix, LaShawna McGinnix, will be coming out of the book of 1 Peter. We'll be talking about holiness again. Our next 2 weeks lesson will be dealing with being holy. Amen. And we thank you for tuning in today and continue to study God's word. Continue to be prayerful that God continue to bless those that stand in need, and that we're able to help those that in the need of prayer and those that are in need of food, or someone that's in the need of shortcoming. If you have something that you can help somebody with, if it ain't nothing but a case of water, help them. Amen. Let's help somebody. Amen. Because God didn't bless us with these things to stay shut up in our homes and keep to ourselves. He wants us to spread abroad, because one thing about Christ and keeping your fist balled up, you can't get nothing in. But when you open your hand up, you can let something in. Amen. All right. Let's go to God in prayer. Holy God, we thank you for inviting us into your holy presence. Be with us as we accept our place as your holy people. Open our hearts that we may love our neighbors and live lives of holiness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Be blessed, everyone.